Oh my God, that is insane. Now let me tell you that the new 2021 16-inch MacBook Pro is pretty ridiculous, but I really was not sure how it was going to compare against my 2020 M1 Mac Mini from a video editing standpoint. I'm a video editor, I edit video several times a week, and time is money, especially when it comes to editing video, because I really want to push out as much content as I can, and I want to remove any bottlenecks that exist in my workflow to alleviate any type of pressure, which will allow me to focus on making videos. Now, for this video, I got my hands on the 16-inch MacBook Pro with M1 Max to see how it compares to my 2020 Mac Mini with M1. What is up, guys? It is Mike. Welcome back to Tech247 TV. I'm glad that you're back with me today. We're talking about the 2021 MacBook Pro and whether or not it's really worth it coming from the 2020 Mac Mini. Now, I bought the Mac Mini as my primary video editing machine, and it was good at first, but over time, as my projects got more complex and as my workflow got more complex, the Mac Mini really started to stress and break down in terms of working on video. So I bit the bullet and decided to upgrade from the 2020 Mac Mini to the 16-inch MacBook Pro with M1 Max. Let's get started. Now, today's video is broken down into different sections, and I have each one of those sections pinned down in the first comment. In terms of configuration, I went with the 16-inch MacBook Pro with M1 Max, and this is the model that has 10-core CPU, which is comprised of 8 high-performance cores and 2 high-efficiency cores. There's 32 gigs of RAM and 32-core GPU. If you're looking at Apple's website, it's broken down by good, better, best, and this is in the best category at $34.99, and then I have 2 terabytes of internal storage. Now, I did have a 1 terabyte version, which I did send back in exchange for this version, which I'll get into more on why I did that in just a few minutes. Now, there are a lot of things to consider when you are upgrading from one machine to the other, and I chose the 16-inch over the 14-inch MacBook Pro for the following reasons. First, it is about usable screen size. I've owned both a 13-inch and a 15-inch MacBook Pro, and both machines really left me wanting more in terms of screen real estate, being able to see more, do more. Really, it just was never enough for me because I edit video several times a week, and Final Cut Pro on the 13-inch without an external display was almost too difficult for me to read. I'm getting older and it's just what happens. Now, I do have my Mac primarily connected to a 5K monitor that is here off the side. When I'm not using it, if I'm around my house, if I'm sitting at a desk where that monitor is available, I want to make sure that I have enough screen real estate to see everything within Final Cut, which is the program that I'm using all the time to edit video. Now, since portability is a secondary concern over screen size, this put me squarely in the 16-inch camp, leaving me to figure out which processor was best for my usage patterns. Second, it's about RAM and SSD speed. Now, my typical video project is somewhere in the neighborhood of about 150 to 400 gigs worth in storage size. That's because I primarily shoot in ProRes 4K on an Atomos recorder, and if I'm not using an Atomos recorder, I'm shooting internally on a Sony camera using their XAVC codec. Now, if you don't know the difference, ProRes is very lightweight. You can ingest it into your computer very easily, and it's very easy for your computer to use and run it. But the problem is that those files are very beefy in size. Now, comparatively, you have the XAVC codec, which is highly compressed, making it smaller in size, but it's harder for computers to use and digest them and read them. So there's a little bit of a trade-off there. So most of my projects are shot both in ProRes 4K and in Sony's XAVC codec in 4K. Even if I estimated my average project size to be 200 to 250 gigs, having a 512 gig hard drive is way, way too small for me. I wouldn't feel comfortable with that. Now, if I were to bump that up to the next level, 1 terabyte, still, I could probably have 1 or 2 projects on there, but not too much past that. I constantly have to manage my projects with an external drive. So for me, 2 terabyte was the right size, and the cost difference between 1 terabyte and 2 terabyte is $400. We're gonna see here in a few minutes here how that drive performs. $400 is actually not very expensive when you consider the performance that you're getting from this drive. The next crucial question for me was how much RAM did I want to have in the new 16-inch MacBook Pro? I had 16 gigs in the 2020 Mac Mini and also in the 2020 13-inch MacBook Pro, but I really felt constrained by the 16 gigs because there's often times where it felt like it was like pulling teeth from the machine when I was doing my edit. It just felt long. There were things that where it would close. I don't think it was a good experience, maybe particularly for my workflow. Now, I wanted to get a little bit more breathing room, so I started from going from 16, which I had previously, to going to 32 gigs of unified memory. Now, I also went to the 32-core version for the GPU, and there's a couple of different benefits from here. So first, the RAM speed is gonna be 4 times as fast in comparison to the M1 Mac Mini MacBook Pro 13-inch, and twice as fast what is found in the M1 Pro. That, in addition, I'm getting 2 ProRes Encode Decode engines, which on the M1 Pro, you only get 1, and on the M1 Mac Mini, you get 0. So there's a lot of benefits by going with this beefier processor that helps me in terms of video editing because of the way that my workflow is structured. Now, going into this, I had a few different questions really based on performance and really what would be the limitations of this upgrade. First, did double the number of performance cores on the 16-inch MacBook Pro directly translate into an increase in multi-threaded performance? Second, given that the GPU cores was going from 8 in the 2020 Mac Mini to 32 cores in the 16-inch MacBook Pro, would I see the same type of scaling effect for GPU-related tasks? And finally, how would the two ProRes Encode-Decode engines really impact my workflow? Because again, I want to invest in technology that's going to shorten my workflow and make it easier to allow me to produce more content. Now, I'm going to answer all these questions throughout the video, but I can tell you right now that I am very satisfied with my upgrade. I think it's the best computer for me, and who knows, it might even be the best computer for you if you have similar needs. Let's get on with the testing. Now, the first test case is going to have to do with setting baselines for ingesting video. Now, the MacBook Pro now has a super fast SSD, which you'll see in just a moment here just how fast it is. But the question is there a bottleneck with the SSD if I were to go ahead and maybe think about replacing it with a external drive like this Thunderbolt drive that I have here from Samsung? I think this is the X5. Now, the reason why you'd want to choose something over this, because presumably this is going to be cheaper than what you are able to purchase from Apple, and you should get similar performance. Well, we're going to see here in just a moment what the case is. Now, I'm going to take this SSD and I'm going to connect it to my MacBook Pro, and I'm going to see what the Thunderbolt read-write speeds are of this drive. I'm going to use the BLACKMAGIC speed disk tool. Now, let's go ahead and select the target drive. Now, for context, this is a $350 SSD drive. It's Thunderbolt 3. The inside interface is going to be NVMe, so it is super fast. It does get hot because of the small enclosure, but it is super fast and it should give you really, really high performance. Now click start, and these speeds right now I'm getting 2300 write and 2600 read, which is nothing to sneeze at. That is extremely fast. But let's take a look here at what the internal drive speed on the MacBook Pro is. Oh my God, that is insane. Now, while we're waiting for this to complete, if you are enjoying this video, consider hitting subscribe, you know, that button right down there, turning on notifications. And if you find value in this content, maybe share it with someone else who might find value, because I think there are a lot of other people like you and I who like this type of content. So we are getting, wow, it's actually even getting faster. It's 6300 and 5400. That is ridiculous. That is twice the amount of speed in comparison to this external SSD drive. So if I was thinking here, if I wanted to save money and go with the 1 terabyte version of the MacBook Pro and not pay the $400 upgrade fee for the 2 terabytes, well, this drive itself is $400 or $350, depending if you can find it on sale. I'm getting half the performance that I would be getting if I were to just spend an extra $50 and get the larger 2 terabyte MacBook Pro. So for me, that seems kind of like it's like a non-issue. You shouldn't even really consider getting the 2 terabyte version because of the performance of this drive is going to be half the speed. Now, speed might not be the entire equation. Let's actually put this to the test and let's start editing video and see what happens. Now, depending on how you are setting this up, the read-write performance of this drive might be a little bit lower if you're connecting it to a dock, which is then connected to your MacBook. You always want to connect any type of external media that you want to maximize throughput on directly to your computer. So that's what you want to make sure you do. And that's how I've connected it here. I'm doing all my tests while they're directly connected to the computer. For the second test case, we are going to see how fast the render performance is of the 2021 MacBook Pro versus the Mac Mini. Now, in context, rendering is the act of making the changes in your project, but not necessarily producing a final deliverable, like a video file that you would then, you know, upload to YouTube. It only makes the changes here on your computer. And you're going to be very surprised what this computer is able to do. Now, I'm going to use my 30-day review of the iPad Mini as my project file. And it's a mix of ProRes 4K, 1080p actually as well, in addition to Sony XAVC 4K. So there's three different resolution sizes that are in here. So it would make for a very good example of how quickly or how slowly something is going to be able to render out those changes. So we are now recording my computer screen. We've got the screen on my camera right here. We have a camera right here and we have the audio, right? Yes, we have the audio. So we have a lot of things being recorded right now. Now, this project file, whoops, like I said, is about 100 gigs in size. Let's just double check here. So you see that here, this is a pretty, say, lengthy video, 12 minutes in length. And I think it produces a 38 gigabyte master file, which is a ProRes file. I'm going to delete all the render files that are in here. Make sure I click on that. Click here. File. I'm going to delete generated media files, delete everything. And you see here on the timeline, all these little dash marks that shows what is unrendered, which is the whole thing. Now, if I were to right click on this and click render all, it's going to render that timeline. Now, rendering is important depending on what you're trying to achieve and the capabilities of your machine. But in context of the M1 Max, it's not necessarily even relevant. You can use your M1 Max with large project files. Again, I'm talking 4K, 8K. Obviously, I can't comment on too much because I don't have an 8K video camera. If you want to let me know where I can find one for a very inexpensive, drop that down below. But you can use your M1 Max without the worry of having to render videos first. This system is so fast and everything works so well together is that you can use your M1 Max while, you know, without rendering a video, and all of your changes are immediately available and previewable on this machine. It's actually just quite, I'd say, mind-boggling how they were able to construct this in such a way where everything works so effortlessly together. Now, for example, the content is still immediately playable. You can click anywhere in this timeline. You could see here, it's like butter. That's how smooth it runs. It is so quick and efficient where on the M1 Mac Mini, that file actually takes 7 minutes and 10 seconds. So it's almost a 50% reduction or twice as fast is another way to look at it. It's actually going twice as fast as the M1 Mac Mini. And that is because of, you know, one, it's the speed of the RAM, two, the speed of the processor, three, the video encode engines that we talked about earlier. So all of these things are working together in such a way where it really makes the experience as someone who has to edit video very enjoyable. So I don't know if you've ever had this, but editing video can sometimes be a pain in the butt because it just takes so long to do. Well, here with the M1 Max, it is literally effortless. Now, another example here where I'm able to output a ProRes master on my M1 Max, which is kind of like a final version that you would use, in 2 minutes and 26 seconds, which that is kind of quick. It's a 12-minute video, and I'm able to export it in 2 minutes. So it's the end of the day, and you need to figure out, does this machine make sense for you, right? Does it make sense? Because it's $3,499 to start, $3,899 the way I've it configured, and obviously it goes up way, way more than that. I don't know what your workflow is. I would say that depending on your workflow, it might make sense, it might not. But I would tell you that look at how much time you are spending in each one of the kind of the components of your workflow, you know, ingestion, editing, rendering, exporting. If there's a potential time savings there, you know, think about how many times per week or per day that you do those, you know, parts of your workflow. If you're exporting videos, you know, several times a week, because maybe you make daily vlogs, and you're saving 5 minutes per vlog or per export, you know, if you do that 7 times a week, that's 35 minutes. If you do that, you know, every week for a month, you can probably save the money on this computer or, you know, kind of recoup the money on your computer much quicker than what you think in terms of return on investment. And can you now do other things within that time that you're saving? Because to me, that's where you're going to see all the return on your investment on this. Now, I would love to know what you think and what you think. Let me know in the comments below, are you going to pick up an M1 Max? And if you are, what configuration are you getting? I think 2 terabytes is the sweet spot for most people, especially if you're having, you know, what I would consider normal size projects, somewhere between 200 and 400 gigabytes in size. My name is Mike. This is Tech 24/7 TV. Guys, if you like this type of video, let me know by subscribing to the video so I can make more content like this for you. I will talk to you in the next one.